In this lecture, we will discuss trisomy 21, or Down syndrome. Trisomy 21 is when a patient has three copies of their 21st chromosome in every cell in their body. These patients have characteristic facial features, like you can see here. They have hypotonia, they have intellectual disability, and they may have congenital malformations. And we'll go through these more carefully in this lecture. So how does this happen? The most common times, about 94% of the time, this is from nondisjunction. Basically, one parent creates two normal gametes, and the other parent creates one gamete with two copies, and the other one simply isn't viable. Then, through freak occurrence, the gamete with two copies fertilizes a normal egg, or the egg has two copies and is fertilized by a normal sperm, and this results in a patient with three copies of the 21st chromosome. So this is nondisjunction. This is about 94% of the time. About 6% of the time, this will happen through Robertsonian translocation. Robertsonian translocation is a little bit complicated, so I want to walk you through it this one time so we all are on the same page. We'll repeat Robertsonian translocations when we talk about other trisomies. But here we have a patient who's normal and a spouse who has a Robertsonian translocation. This spouse is completely normal from the standpoint of how they appear to you or how they interact with you. This patient has two blue chromosome 14s. I just chose 14 as an example. Then, for chromosome 21, a piece of it has been translocated onto the end of one of those 14 chromosomes. So they have the appropriate amount of chromosomal material in each cell, it's just mislocated with half of one chromosome being adhered to another. That's the Robertsonian translocation. But now let's watch what happens when a patient who has translocation then goes and has a child with a normal individual and what happens to the various opportunities for their offspring. So let's consider a case where a parent who has a normal genome is going to have a baby with a parent who has a Robertsonian translocation. The normal parent will make two gametes. These will both be normal, one copy of 21, which are the red ones, and one copy of 14, which are the blue ones. However, the parent who is a translocation carrier will make six possible gametes, and you can see them all drawn here, with the lowest one being a normal gamete, but the others all being variations. Now, when these two parents make an offspring, it's possible that they may make a normal offspring, as you can see in this picture, with the lowest gamete in the translocated carrier matching up with one of the normal gametes from the normal patient. However, they may also make trisomy 14. That's not viable. That child will not come to be. Or they could create yet another translocation carrier, like the translocation carrier in the first example. This child will grow to be a carrier of Down syndrome, but will not have any manifestations of Down syndrome. Or they could make a monosomy 21, which is not viable. This child will not come into being. Or alternatively, they could create a translocation such that this patient has Down syndrome. They have essentially three copies of the 21st chromosome. One of them is adhered to their 14th chromosome. Or alternatively, they could create monosomy 14. That's not viable either. So essentially, the odds are for this couple that they can either have a normal child, a child who is put at risk for creating children in the next generation in a similar way, or a child with Down syndrome. So let's look now at risks for Down syndrome. The biggest risk that we have to consider is the maternal age. With women who get older, as they get older, it's more and more likely for them to create eggs that have an extra copy of a 21st chromosome. And you can see the risk here. So generally, we consider 35 a point at which the risk starts to really come up, and after 40, it comes up dramatically. And those are the risks you can see. So let's say we have a baby and we're wondering whether they might have Down syndrome. This is a diagnosis that's frequently made on physical exam, and there are some classic physical exam findings that we can see. One is they can have epicanthal folds, or upslanting fissures of their eyes. They may have mid-face hypoplasia. You can see that a little bit in this child. They may have brachycephaly. They may have a little bit of excessive skin behind the neck. Sometimes we can see that in utero on ultrasound. You may see something called a palmar crease. This is where that crease goes straight across the hand instead of branching like it normally does. You may see a slight gap between the first and second toes, much like a flip-flop sandal. It's where that flip-flop post would go, and you may see that gap there. And you can see small white spots in the iris, which are called brush field spots. That can be associated with Down syndrome. Patients with Down syndrome have other issues that can be more consequential. One example is congenital heart disease, and this can show up in as many as 50% of patients. And the most common is what we call an endocardial cushion defect, which is also called the common AV canal. This is when they have both a VSD and an ASD, essentially creating one large chamber in the heart. Patients with Down syndrome are at increased risk for duodenal atresia, about 12% of the time. As you can see here, they'll have that classic finding of the double bubble sign on abdominal x-ray. Very early in life, they'll present quite quickly with inability to eat and inability to defecate. And you can see that double bubble area, where one bubble is the stomach and the other bubble is the accrual of air before that area of duodenal atresia. Patients may develop congenital hypothyroidism. This hopefully will be picked up on their newborn screen. If not, we want to address it as quickly as possible. These infants have it about 1% of the time among patients with Down syndrome. And hearing loss and especially frequent otitis media is common in patients with Down syndrome as well. They may develop eye disease, such as cataracts or refractive errors. They may develop poor growth. In fact, patients with Down syndrome should be plotted along their own special growth curve, which is available online. They may have increased risk for celiac disease. They may have atlantoaxial instability. So, atlantoaxial instability is an instability of C1 on C2 of their vertebrae. We used to recommend x-ray screening, though now we've decided that is no longer particularly beneficial, although it may be required for participation in the Special Olympics, which is important for these kids. Additionally, they may have an increased risk of leukemia, and that is very important.